Thank you again, everyone. Good morning, maybe. Still good morning. Thank you, good morning. Thank you. Morning. Okay, thank you. So now we talk a little bit about the shila or six paramitas with this. I don't want to read this all because my accents, I don't know if you will understand what I'm reading, even though maybe you're looking in the book, but I will talk with about the six paramita and then talk about the shila, and then you ask me questions, and then I try to answer whatever I can. Okay, so that's how we follow that. And now, about the generally speaking about the shila. Shila is a Sanskrit word, and in English it many times translated as moralities. And also it is kind of can be synonym as morality or conduct or ethics. So all that, I think, I believe is very synonyms. And generally in the Buddha's teaching, overview of the Buddha's teaching, when you take the bodhicitta, when you bodhicitta is love and compassion and wisdom that combined together is called known as bodhicitta, and in Sanskrit, that Sanskrit word, and is translated into English as mind of enlightenment. So what is mind of enlightenment? Is mind of enlightenment is compassion, loving kindness, wisdom, and thinking of all living beings, how to benefit, help to the beings, everyone. That thought, and at the same time, order to benefit to all beings, but I like to become also more enlightened, because order to make the professional way to help to the others, you have to be well equipped yourself. You have to be strong. To order to be strong, that means you're not kind of obscured and disturbed by the emotions. And for that reason, I like to become the enlightenment or become the Buddha, so that I can help to all the living beings. So what is for that reason, what in the Buddha's teaching says, bodhicitta means has two aspects. By compassion and loving kindness thought, projecting that to all the living beings without any discriminations. By wisdom, you're projecting to the how can make more powerfully, more effectively, and that is become Buddha. Then I can effectively benefit it for beings. So looking by the wisdom, looking to the enlightenment, and by the compassion and love, looking to this all the living beings. So that then, because of combination of that two, all the love and the compassion and wisdom, then you develop the bodhicitta. So you develop the bodhicitta. And bodhicitta is now what actually we all have love, we all have compassion, we all have wisdom. It's not something we don't have. But this time, developing means we open that love and compassion and wisdom to all the living beings. Now, present time, our love and compassion is kind of limited. We have kind of restricted in a way. Way is it like not completely opened. But this time, when you take the bodhicitta, really you open your heart and opening the wisdom, compassion, love to all living beings without any discrimination. That attitude, that openness feeling, openness thought, is known as bodhicitta. Bodhicitta. So once you develop, or when you really activated that quality in heart and mind, how we're going to activate that? How now we're going to carry that on? That is just a thought. Now this thought, we're going to activate it that through the four boundless. You all know. boundless of compassion, boundless of loving kindness, boundless of joy, and boundless equanimity or rejoice. These four boundless. Four boundless, that means all the living beings. Your boundless love to all living beings, boundless compassion to all the living beings, boundless joy and rejoice to all living beings, and yourself balance it. Balance it, and as well as without discrimination. That is called boundless of equanimity. That combined, that uphold the love and compassion and wisdom, the bodhicitta call it. You hold that. Now you activate that strongly in heart and mind. Now when that comes to the action, how to activate that to benefit to the others, then in the Buddha's teaching said six paramitas are first the general. Six paramitas, again, paramita is a Sanskrit word, and I think you all know basically. So, but good paramita means that will lead beyond. Paramita in Sanskrit means will lead beyond. What that means? Beyond the duality, beyond the regiment attitude of the self-important. It goes beyond completely, and then also means beyond the samsara. This well, for those are what therefore this six paramita, the six of these will lead us beyond the dualities, beyond the samsara. It will take over because we now you have the compassion and love or the poor boundless in heart and mind so strongly, and now you're activating that with this through these six different techniques or paramitas. And those six paramitas, you all started, you know. The generosities, morality, or shila, which is translated in Sanskrit. Sanskrit, shila, and then patience, and joyful effort, and concentrations, and wisdoms. Those Sanskrit words, is not necessarily, I think, important, but if you like to hear this, I'm sure it's here too. And the generosity is in Sanskrit called the dana paramitas. And morality is known as Sanskrit shila paramitas. The patient paramita is known as in Sanskrit chanti paramitas. And then joyful effort paramita is known as in Sanskrit briya paramitas. And then in the concentration paramita is known as in Sanskrit dhyan paramitas. And then in the wisdom paramita is known as in Sanskrit then panja paramitas. So those are six paramitas. And now these six paramitas are overviewing. I mean, of course, you all know, started this, you all know this, but overviewing these six paramitas. Now, these, what are those? First, generosity is like giving to the others. And morality then, and is shila is moralities. When you give things to the others, generous is generally great. But when you give things, you have to stand also with ethics. Ethics, you have to have moralities. Moralities. And so when you have the good, you have the open mind, open heart, and generosity, you have good ethics, but then also you need patience. Patience is what? Courage and commitment, confidence, not lingering and not disturbed by the external any force. When you do have the good generosity, when you have the good moralities, samsara of the world, there's a lot of troubles. Even you're doing really so good, still maybe it's not going to accept as it's good. Your open heart, your open mind, not going to maybe accept everyone as that so pure. For that reason, we need also patience, courage, and commitment. Patience means what? In another word, in the Sanskrit, the great master Shanti Deva said, he's in the famous teaching, what is the nature of the patient? Not disturbed. Not disturbed. That is the nature of that. So no matter whatever it is, you're not disturbed. That is patience. the essence of patience. And then, to keep up this, we need joyful effort. Effort, but joy. Joy of generosity, joy of morality, and joy of the patience. It's not something that we're dragging and kind of overloaded and kind of doing this pathetically. We're doing this. We're doing this with full of a vision, goal, something important, not just a self-centered mind kind of thinking, really thinking to all living beings, how wonderful, how beautiful, how special. For that reason, great master Shantideva said, also in his teaching, said, all these so many things, so many purpose, peoples are doing all, just so many things in the world, in the summertime with summer heat, in the wintertime with winter cold. Day and night they're walking. They can bear that cold just for their own purposes. I'm doing this for all living beings. Really, my project is to help to all living beings. Why I cannot bear? Why I should not have the joy? You're not just for yourself, you're for all the living beings. This is a big vision, big goal, big result, big benefit to you and to the everyone. This is like win-win situations. Truly, for that reason, why I should not have joy? Why I should not have aspirations? Your heart is good, your mind is good, your action is good, your object is good, and we will be good. For that reason, joyful effort. Joyful effort is what the great master Shantideva said, when you have the joy. And we have the joy, whatever activity is, then it comes so easily. And we don't have the joy, what is opponent is known as laziness. Laziness will take over because lack of joy, lack of unappreciation, or lack of appreciation. That's it. And when now you have the beautiful like generosity, morality, and patience, joyful effort. Now, what are all those? Those are one way, all kind of more outreaching qualities, in a way. Or particularly, first three, generosity, morality, is patience, is more outreaching, more outer. Now that this fifth paramita is directly dealing with the mind. Mind is the most powerful, important. Even though it's unseen, we can't see, nobody can really see this mind. But this unseen, this mind is controlling our every situation, every circumstances, everything. So therefore, the young paramita is directly dealing with our own, this invisible mind. Mind, and mind is restless. Mind is running all the time. You know, we know, we started this. And even when we're sitting down on the cushion, where we're kind of like physically very calm and peaceful, maybe our mind is running. Mind, that's how the mind is. Always. Dhyan means calm and peaceful, abiding in its own natural status. The mind. Mind. Reside, abiding in his own sport. That explaining the young. And then the wisdoms. Wisdom means understanding, knowing exactly where things are. Also, great master was called Shantideva said, what is dhyan? Dhyan means not distracted. That is really the meaning of dhyan or the concentrations, not distracted. And then the wisdom. The wisdom is knowing exactly as it is. Nothing overstated, understated where things are. Where things are on the mundane level, where things are beyond the mundane or behind the scene. Exactly as it is. Not kind of cover up, not making stories, this and that things, kind of, or not imagination, this and but exactly as it is. Those are the, in Buddhism was called. The relative truth and absolute truth. Seeing things exactly as an relative truth, seeing things exactly as an absolute truth. So that is like kind of generally overview of this six paramitas. Now six paramitas, entirely generally Buddha teaching can be summarized into three practices. Or again, to summarize this, those are known as what? You all know, three trainings: morality, and concentration, and wisdoms. Those are the three trainings. Entire Buddha practices, teachings can be summarized into these themes. So now, if we summarize this all six paramitas into three, how we do this? First three, generosity, morality, patience, all can be summarized into moralities. Moralities, and fifth is concentration, and that is the concentration, and then wisdom, and that is wisdom. So three: morality, concentration, and wisdoms. And what about then joyful effort? Joyful effort is support to all of them. Joyful need, joyful effort for the morality, we need joyful effort for the concentration, we need joyful effort for the wisdoms. So that is just a kind of overview of the six paramitas. And now, if you have some questions, I will discuss, or maybe you're talking about the shilas now. About the shila. Shila is now about the six paramitas. Second is shila paramitas. Shila means, as I already said, is conduct, is moralities, is ethics. The morality and conduct or ethics, or whatever we use the terminologies, this is so important. I mean, generally all six paramitas are so important, but morality is really so important. What you heard, for example, meditation, when we meditate, we need moralities. Morality, without the moralities, we won't go far. For that reason, great master Nagarjuna said in his letter to friend, he said, morality is like ground, like earth. Morality is like earth, because earth is the base of everything, everyone, whether we move or whether we don't move, or movable, immovable, everyone is relying on the earth. Similarly, morality is the base of everything. All the good realization, good achievement, good fulfillment based upon the moralities. Even you have the good wisdoms, good concentrations, if we don't have the good morality, it falling apart. It will fail apart. It will go away. We will really lose the ground. Therefore, morality is so important. I mean, this is so important. For that reason, what? In Sanskrit, known as shila. Shila is translated as, can be translated as cools. When you have the shila, and it also in English too, I think, when you have the morality, you are a cool guy, I think. Yeah, really, you're a cool guy. That person is a gentleman. That person is a gentle lady. I mean, if you don't have the morality, no matter how much you're educated, how much you're rich, how much you're powerful, you are not gentle. You're not cool. Cool. Because for shila, Sanskrit word, translated it has meaning, coolness. It is cool. For that reason, every Buddha teaching, explaining that you have to have the wisdom, you have to have the understanding, you have to do the meditation, but if you don't have the moralities, we lost it. For that reason, Buddha gave the teaching, for example, in the Vinaya teaching, there's moralities of the teaching for the lay practitioners, how they should be behaved. This is not just making Buddhas bound, making boundaries by Buddhas, kind of restricting, but how to maintain their identity, quality, their upkeeping, the goodness. That is good for them, or for us, for everyone. That is really guidelines, simple upkeeping instructions, how to maintain beautifully, not just maintaining, but how we continue beautiful success, fulfillment, and all the way to the Buddhahood, enlightenment. That is morality. Morality is so important. Morality is then, I see here too, explaining morality that in samsara morality, which means traditions, rules, regulations, systems of the countries, or the tradition, respect and appreciate. Follow that wherever country we stay. We should respect and appreciate, follow the rules. All the rules, most of the rules are really kind of designed to help, to good for us. Something that is good for you, good for others, to everyone. Therefore, rules are very important. That's called the moralities. If we keep them perfectly, we are then completely beautiful. Beautiful, what's called? Beautiful nephew and niece of Uncle Sam's. Things. Beautiful nephew. You're really cool, then Uncle Sam will be very happy. Oh, they are really good. If we don't do that, and Uncle Sam will look at what's called on the sideways, side eye. Side eye. So therefore, rules and regulations are really good in Buddha teaching. So very important, respect and appreciate any samsara guidelines, rules, regulations, that something is benefiting to the other beings and not hurting. Not hurting to anyone. Anyone is good. It's good that. In the Dharma, the rules and regulations, and then there's so many samayas. So many vows, so many instructions, that really how to keep up that. All is something that to guard ourselves. Guard, G-U-A-R-D, I think, guard ourselves. Guard our physical activities, guard our verbal activities, and guard our mental activities. Mental activities from negativities, from disturbance to me, to one's own self, to the others. Then Buddha give all those guidelines how to really sustain so beautiful, calm, and peaceful. If we keep this morality, then it's really good for us and good for the others. It will become more gentle, more peaceful, more pleasing. Life will become more rich, more simple, more calmer. And then also just kind of with that feeling, that quality, it's really become so rich. Reach and help to the other beings according to your capabilities, or the according to readiness for others, and then that is known as basically moralities. And then morality can be divided, I'm sure it's mentioned there too. If we go more kind of detailed morality in the Buddha teaching, those are known as morality that will stop all the negativities, and morality that will gathering all the virtues, and morality that will benefit for all living beings. So those are three moralities. Morality stopping all the negative activities, and by directly, indirectly, that is the one. And morality that gathering all the virtues, all the good things, learn good things, improve yourself, good things, and skills, method, that something is beneficial to you, to the others, in the context of the peace and harmony, we should learn those things. Those. And then, morality that benefits to all living beings, then help to the others as much as you can, with gentle, with peaceful, with respectfully, and help to the others according your capabilities and according readiness of the receivers or receives. And you do help to that. Those are known as three moralities. I'm sure it is mentioned that. So that is my brief kind of overview of the moralities and the six paramitas. And now if you have some questions, I'm really happy to answer as much as I can. Thank you. Thank you.
So I have a question.
Yes, yes.
My question is, of course, morality starts from the family, right?
Pardon?
Family, morality, you know, you teach children.
Oh, yeah, of course, yeah.
Like that. Mm-hmm. That's very good, that is expected. That is the first school of the life. But when you look around the world, it has not been the part of the school and college and university. Why they don't, it is so important, so why they don't incorporate morality in the education? Uh-huh. Of course, you are talking about ethics and morality in the workplace.
Uh-huh.
There's a small introduction, you know, just presentation. But as I feel and everybody feels that it should be part of the education in the school, college and university. Why we have not been able to do that?
That's true. This, I think, is most of the time, I believe, is due to the really different kind of like what's called the habit patterns, and also due to the kind of like some people not so emphasizing on the moralities. Some people do that. That's the way of their habit, and maybe more emphasizing of the kind of starting learning things, which is so important. That but morality sometimes they kind of ignore, and many times also practitioners think that meditation is so important, and practicing is kind of like practice sitting is so important. But many times, Dharma practitioners are kind of not so kind of keen or thinking of the moralities, but morality is really so important in Buddhism. When you don't have the good morality, I said many times, then it can fall apart, and then just fall apart. So therefore, morality and the practice goes side by side. If you keep these two together, then really is fulfillment. Really comes so beautifully. So therefore, I will say, just in the world they don't, and I think it's due to the habitual, due to the traditions, due to the also maybe a different kind of in a way beliefs and so forth, and then just kind of they blow it up, and then they focus the more kind of like studying or more those things in a school. And which is so important, but when that happened, and then many times, I think morality is really good. That I will say. Yes, yes, please, yeah. Yeah, okay, yeah.
Thank you, Khenpo. Is it possible for us to have good intentions but lack morality?
Yeah, definitely that happened. That can happen. Have the good intentions, we have the very beautiful intentions, and then maybe the good morality, because Buddha morality is also based on the nice understanding, and then you have to also really have to see how, for example, your intention is good, but how it is going to work. You have to be, that is what's called, the kind of knowing that as much as we can, that knowledge is called wisdoms. So morality is guided by wisdoms. So even you have the good intention, good things, but if it's going to benefit, is work for you and work to the others, or work is good for many ways, really always observe it. And that is really very important. Yes, yeah, please.
In the way of the Bodhisattva, the poem by Shantideva, he says that when you're generating bodhicitta, or when you're trying to not let it diminish, in that four line thing, for those without it may it be generated.
Yeah, yeah, both of you.
Those who have it may it not diminish but always be increasing.
Mm-hmm.
He said all three sort of stages, you have to whip up a sense of urgency. And many years ago, I saw Krishnamurti in Switzerland in 1970. He said, if you were in a house that was on fire, there'd be real urgency to get out.
Mm-hmm.
How do you recommend whipping up a sense of urgency to practice?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of doing it, I remember the Dalai Lama was saying, we're not supposed to become marshmallows.
Mm-hmm.
How would you recommend whipping up a sense of urgency?
I think, of course, urgency generally, the practice is really practicing that to connect to our heart and mind with the context of love and compassion, bodhicitta, that's what we're talking. It is really the most important in our lives. Our lives, all the activities are important, but to compare with the bodhicitta, all the other activities are secondaries. Really secondaries. Love and compassion, this verse is so important. So precious to you and to all the other beings. So therefore, And the life is also how long we are going to stay. We don't know how long. Well, everything is in our situation. Well, everything is in kind of in our reachable state. As use this time, make this precious time, as really is so important. It's very urgent. In the one in the teaching said, you say, in the great masters, you say, do practice and don't wait. Check now. Now is the most important. Use these opportunities. Use this opportunity as examples. If the snake, if snake comes on the lap of the timid person, what that timid person will do? He's not going to wait until this. Get up immediately. Said as snake entered in the timid lap of the timid person, or the beautiful Miss American catch the fire on hair, what she will do? She will immediately act something to do out that. In the teaching, said take like as important, urgent as that. Really, say like that, catching the fire on the beautiful girls, ladies. I just said, Miss America, I'm sorry, I just not said that. But beautiful ladies catch the fire on their heads, or enter in the snag in the timidest lap. That's really said. It's true. I mean, look, life is so precious. Life is so important. But something that when we leave this world, if we really cultivate the bodhicitta, if we did like do something with the bodhicitta activities, that's something. It makes us happy, makes more confidence, more stronger to ourselves and to the other beings. That's what the great master Shantideva said too. Yes?
Rinpoche, in our study group, we've been trying to get a clearer understanding of the meaning of the word transcendental.
Mm-hmm.
And in this context, like when are paramitas regular paramitas, and when are paramitas transcendental?
Okay. Paramitas? Actually, this paramita is a Sanskrit word. I think it's translated into English. I thought transcendental itself. And what if paramita, if we kind of translate it roughly, exactly as word paramita, then I think it means it will take you other shore. Paramita is one which will take to the other shore. So this means that this shore where we are is a samsara. Or if I use the word today, duality. But if you continue practice these six paramitas, it will take you the other shore, shore of nirvana or shore of the beyond the samsara or dualities. So that. And that, what is that actually? How do you do that? That is actually what in the teaching said. When that will become, when our generosity will become the transcendental or the paramita of generosity or dana paramitas. When we don't have the grasping, we don't have the grasping on the subject, when we don't have the grasping on the object, when we don't have the grasping on the action. So subject and object, action, when we don't have the grasping, that is known as then your generous practice is transcendental or the paramita, your morality is paramita. Paramita, everything becomes then paramita. Until that also indicated, even we do the generosity, even though the all is within the frame of dualities, which is good. This duality will lead us beyond the duality. This is a good remedy in a way, as I always think they're like homeopathic systems. You use the same remedy in order to cure that obstacles. So we're using this, we don't have any other choice, we're using it skillfully with the duality to go beyond the dualities. And when the duality, beyond the duality, then it is transcendental or paramitas.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
Thank you, Rinpoche. I don't know if very often in our culture we would think about doubt as being immoral.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, as among the negative emotions mentioned here as part of an immorality, could you talk a little bit about
doubt has is not necessarily always negatives. Doubt has two aspects. A doubt is one aspect is aspect of the wisdom's intelligence, and for that reason, for example in the Buddha's teaching, what is called studying and contemplations. When you are contemplating, you can have doubt. That means you're asking questions, you're putting inquiry to yourself or to the others to make sure it is true. And to make that sure, that is aspect is doubt or that inquiry thought is good, is nothing really wrong that. But once you establish it, once you establish the concrete certainty wisdoms, then doubt is obstacles. Then it pulls back to you. Then it brings the unsuccessful, you won't achieve that. But during the process of investigation and analyzations, you can have doubt. Doubt is not really nothing bad. And then, for example, during our meditation, during the practices, and we have started doubt, that become obstacles. Because you already established, you already know the practice, you already know this, and we start putting inquiries, then it's just a delay, it's another conception, it's obstacles. Okay. Yes, yes.
Rinpoche, Scott will bear me out in this. I find so much immorality in the world now, compared to when I was a child growing up, that I can't watch the news or see what's going on because I am so sad and I am so angry and I feel so helpless with the lack of morality in the world right now. And I know that doubt and anger and all of this is clinging. But I'm a small person with a little life, and there's nothing I can do in that world. I can only practice. So how can I overcome this judgment of lack of morality and also use my practice to be of benefit?
No, this is true. This looks like, I mean, I don't know. Of course, it's generally, soja in the samsara, according to Buddha teaching, and I'm sure it's true, same thing. In the samsara, there's so, in all this world, it's always had a lot of emotions, a lot of troubles, a lot of dismoralities. Really, this is not just new. I think it's always like being like, I believe that maybe sometimes a little bit more on the surface, but sometimes not too much on the surface, but it's basically, it's just always like this. Now it looks like these times more on the surface, kind of really so many violence going all over the world or many places, and then violence, and then also natural disasters also really erupting, and then also all these difficult troubles, so many things happening one after another, that is true. It's now looks like really kind of so many things. But I think when this happened, I think so what we do, if we can really generate more bodhicittas. More bodhicitta, more compassion. All this happening, according to Buddha's teaching, is due to the ignorance. So ignorance is really to blame. The ignorance is manipulating to everything, and then during all this happening, this reflecting this ignorance in the form of then, of course, in anger, or jealous, hatredness, or combination, and or the greedy, and then all these troubles are happening. So therefore, it is really like, according to Buddha's teaching, really as much as we can generate the bodhicitta and do our prayers, may that not happen. As much as with this, as our four boundless prayers, may all living beings free from the suffering, the cause of suffering, may they they will never be disassociated from the supreme happiness, which is without the suffering. I mean, that those four boundless prayers really do as much as we can, and our positive wishing power is what we can contribute to calm down this. If we do this, Maybe you don't see the immediately effect, immediately that, but you're making peace. This peace started with you. Really started from your own home. Home and spread that. You truly, whoever do this, we become peacemakers. Really peacemaker. We're making peacemaker very kind of grassroots and practical way. We can't make the peace to everyone immediately as well, but we started. That's what our gracious teacher Buddha said. Do yourself. That's it, really. So I think that's the really. And then the pray, and then of course we can get emotions, upset over seeing situation, all the different news things, but just really like also put the Dzogchen meditation kind of let it go. I mean, we can't do anything what except do the pray and kind of make ourselves kind of a little more stronger, calmer and peaceful. If we do that, then really we are doing some good differences. Okay.
Thank you. Appreciate
it. Thank you.
I have read about and known many teachers who have fallen from grace. Usually misconduct, sexual misconduct. And these are people who I think were enlightened masters, beings. Do we forgive them? And how do we look to somebody who is a great teacher and who falls because of lack of morality?
I think that it's definitely like our morality, as you said, that is true, exactly true. But then when that happened, I think so. The teachers also really, I don't know, I mean, I think there's, according to Buddha's teaching, again, I'm talking with according to Paramitas Buddhism, that all the sentient beings has imperfect. And all the teachers, they may be great teachers, but they are not Buddhas, enlightened beings. And therefore, anybody can do mistakes. And for that reason, I think it's really forgive and excuse and learn from that lesson. Lesson and see how that happened, and may other teachers, and my including our one's own self, may not fall down in these kind of situations. May I have always good morality, good conduct, and good bodhicitta. So wish and pray, but excuse and forgive, and that is known as what? Again, we generally practice here six paramitas. Among the six paramitas, and that is also really when you give the forgive, it is a generosity. It is generous. You're giving forgiveness, and it's part of generosity. It's also is part of the ignorance that happened. Feel compassion, improve, learn from that, and then move forward, not become that become the obstacle to progress, growth of our own developments. Thank you. Yes?
I have a question. Is there something kind of like a national karma? I mean, we have our individual karma, but sometimes it feels like we're swept up in a tide, you know? Like if our, say, our country goes to war or something, we may not believe in that, may think it's terrible, but somehow we're part of it. Is there a kind of way to deal with that, or is that imagination, or is karma
always individual? No, this is, of course, karma is a very complexity. Complexity, according to Buddha teaching, it is which is true. I mean, it's really complexity. But however, according to Buddha teaching, this is definitely some degree of karma. There's called the individual karma and a group karmas. Group karmas, and this is something that we're going through in the world or whatever the suffering going generate, this is called group karmas. And how that happened, according to Buddha's teaching, and because karma or our birth is not just the first time or no, it will be last. And therefore, each time, many times we do grouply also kind of activity, action together, and that really known as the group karmas. And then consequence, the result, that will come then sometimes later or that lifetime or afterward. And so what we're experiencing, many times this can be, it's like also a group karma too. Thank you. Okay. Yeah?
It's also a question kind of along the lines of what Mimi was asking about doubt.
Mm-hmm.
I also sometimes understood your answer as being, when you're developing an understanding, then it's okay to question so you can develop a better understanding. But then once you have an understanding and you get involved in practice, then you should have confidence, right?
That's true.
I have a problem, though. Sometimes doubts continue coming up throughout my practice. I don't doubt the core teachings of the Buddha, but sometimes specific explanations, either philosophical or something that I read in a text. Part of it could be that when I hear explanations, maybe the explanation that works for one person is not the same as the explanation that would work for me, but it creates instability in my practice.
No, this is generally questions or the doubt about the your philosophical systems or the questions about the philosophical systems, I think that's really okay. It's not really an obstacle. But during your practices, during for half hour your meditation or practices or 15 minute meditation practices or whatever you have the time, don't use that time as questioning of the philosophical systems. You have the 24 hours in the day, and this time you're spending half an hour. That is not the questioning time. That is the practicing time. So trying to be wise of our time. After that, then you can have questions. It's okay. You can, for that reason, gracious teacher Buddha said, you should not have, don't have to accept my word as you say. Your exam as goldsmith exam, gold, burn, cut, rub and see the authenticness of the cut. That. So you can exam, but once you, during the practices, should not have any questions, then is a scattered mind. If it's scattered mind, the conception, it is like monkey mind. It's disturbing to our meditation. So really don't. Trying to kind of, every question thought comes or doubt comes, I'm not going to, now I'm going to practice. Just really do the practice. That means, practice means you settled. You settled. But the contemplation, starting contemplation and meditation. Practice means meditation, or meditation means practice. Then you settled. Now you're going to develop that. That really, I will say that. That's it. But then one, for example, also in the practices, you've been practicing a long time, long been practicing, suddenly something kind of doubt comes. Suddenly that. That is then is called, in the most of the time in the Buddha teaching, is obstacles. Then comes it kind of, oh, why this and that, kind of like, almost like kind of unthought for thing, kind of doubt and hesitations, or something come up, and then kind of like his practice become shaky, and that is obstacles. And I mean, that happened, let it go. Don't analyze of any of those things, and restrain your bodhicitta, feel more close connected to the Guru Pema Sambha or the Buddha Shakyamuni, really feel the blessings, and wish that restrengthen your confidence and practices. And that happened many times also in the Buddha teaching said, and many times those people who practice ancient time in the caves, in the mountains, they practice for many years and so going beautiful, all the practices, so beautiful, nice and wonderfully, and suddenly something came up in the thought or the, in the dream or the vision or this and that things, then kind of like completely that strength is diminishing that. And that is obstacles, hindrance. That obstacle, hindrance, also according to Buddha teaching, is nothing bad. Actually, it means you're improving, you're growing, you're developing. In any way, that obstacle, that whatever comes, it is like, as like, what's called here, growing pains. your growing pains. So you're growing that. But if you carry by that force, then it really becomes the obstacle. Really, then it will knock down us. So therefore, restrain the courage, restrain the commitment, restrain the devotions, restrain the bodhicitta, feel closeness to the Buddha and Gaurapema Sambhava lineage masters, and just embracing that and mingle with that, and then do the good things, and then we will fly very high and beautiful and relax, and then enjoy the panoramic views. Okay. Yes, please.
Kampala, as long as you are on that that same this realm of train of thought, it struck me that sometimes when I need to, when it's my time for practice, I set aside certain days and certain times, but sometimes I just feel a little distracted and I say, and when I actually push myself, I try to, and I sit and practice, I have my session, and things come to my mind, and it kind of fights through my doubts, and I still come up with new awakenings. Should I trust what my mind comes to?
No,
I think it's on the same train of thoughts as the doubts, as the gentleman said. But should I trust that even when I feel a little shaky? Then when I'm on my mat, my cushion, my mind steadies with whatever I'm coming up with. Should I trust that?
No. Because this practice means that when you're sitting down on the cushion, you're going to practice. And that means actually what we, if we say another word, we say you're going to cultivate your positive mind. That session is cultivating, you dedicated that session of 1 hour, half hour, 15 minutes is cultivating the positive mind one way. So there any thought comes that something is opposite of the positive, really let that thought goes and generating more positive thought, among that maybe more compassion, more joy, more appreciation, and just bring that thought. I mean, we have many reasons to be feel happy and joy, more graceful. Bring those. Practice is not just Buddha teaching, it's not just one single thing. It's a variety of the positive energy. You have to cultivate it and bring that and reveal our own beauty. So really, more compassion, more loving kindness, more joy, more graceful, whatever. Just feel that power and feel the presence of the Buddha. Buddha is sitting right in front of us with golden glowing light. Buddha is full of love, compassion, wisdom, radiating that light of love and compassion to you and to all the beings. How wonderful, how fortunate. I'm the one of the beautiful, fortunate beings on this planet. Really feel that. I mean, truly you are, we are. Each of that, just being. That is actually, in Buddhism, that is practice. That is Dharma. It's not something that you're doing on Dharma. That is the heart of the practices. Then relax. Then meditate. Calm and peaceful. Not thinking, thoughts carry that. Relax. Okay. Thank you. Okay, thank you everyone again. Thank you so much. Okay. Thank you everyone. Thank you. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you. Then we do 1 minute again, calm meditation, and then dedicate one praise in this text. question. If you have this text, this booklet, page 14 and 7, number 7, we join this. Yeah, and then the precious bodhicitta, in those without it may it be generated. In those who have it may it never be demolished, but always continuous. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Rinpoche, thank you very much for being here. I know that this your visit brings a lot of joy to everyone in this room. Thank you so much, Lama Lorraine. It's a pleasure to have you here with us today. I'd like to share with you that Khenpo will be joining us next Sunday and will join us for book discussion again. So please join us. I also like to mention that we have begun the registration for the winter retreat. The beautiful flyer is outside, as well as the registration form. For those of you interested in attending, if you do it, you register before January 30th, we will have a $30 discount available for you. December 30th. That is, if you register before December 30th, there is a $30 discount in the registration. We also have a lot of people who come from out of town, and if you're fortunate enough to have a space in your home for